Your ladder shall be greater than your rest. You shall be blessed more than you can ask. Despite all that has been done, your best is yet to come. Oh, the ladder shall be greater. Your ladder shall be greater. Oh, your ladder shall be greater than the rest. Your ladder shall be greater than your past. You shall be blessed more than you can ask. Despite all that has been done, your best is yet to come. Oh, your ladder shall be greater. I'm so glad my ladder will be greater. Oh, my ladder will be greater than the rest. All things are possible. Don't you know? They are possible. All things are possible. All things are possible. All things are possible. So glad they are possible. All things are possible. Hallelujah. I'm glad all things are possible. Oh, yes, your ladder shall be greater. Your ladder shall be greater. Oh, yes, your ladder shall be greater. Your ladder shall be greater. Won't you believe it? Thank you, Jesus, for my ladder. Oh, your ladder. Oh, oh, your ladder shall be greater than the rest. The more I seek you, the more I find you. The more I find you, I love you. I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe. Feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace. it's overwhelming. Overwhelming joy. Yes. Overwhelming love. Overwhelming love. Overwhelming love. I wanna sit at your feet and drink from the cup in your hand and leave there against you and breathe. Let me feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep. It's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace. It's overwhelming. Your Lord, overwhelming love, overwhelming peace, overwhelming joy, overwhelming love. Oh, peace like a river, yeah, peace like a river. Oh, peace like a river, peace like a river in my soul. Overwhelming grace. I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, and lay back against you and breathe. Feel your heart beat. This love is so deep. It's more than I can stand. And I melt in your peace. It's overwhelming. Amen,
amen, amen. We bless God today. Thank you, Sister Lesa. Amen. Sister Lesa Boykin, the overwhelming love that I have to just sit at your feet and just lean back.
Yeah.
Amen. How much do you love him today? I bless him, Father, with all that I am. We thank God for a chance to again look upon his word, again come into his presence, again come together to give praise and honor to God. And we start with a word of prayer. We're excited today because we have a young lady with us, Sister Anya Covington, who's going to come and share after the prayer. Father God, we come today in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, and we bless you. We bless you, Lord, the best that we know how. We lift you up. We magnify your holy name. We know that you're God and you're God alone. We put our trust, Lord, not in ourselves, not in our government, not in our families, but we put our trust in you. And Lord, you never failed us yet. Thank you, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we be safe today. I pray, Lord, that our families are safe. I pray, Lord, that our loved ones, dear Lord, are safe. I pray that you just watch over us as we go through this time of fear and turmoil. I pray for Sharon Carpenter as she continues her procedures. I pray for Brother Andrew Garrett, for David Thompson, and the Jackson family and the loss of their loved one. I pray for Sister Yarborough. I pray for Sister Gamble. I pray for Sister Johnson. I pray for Brother Gooch. I pray, Father, for your word today, that it might go forth in power and in truth, and that hearts might be changed, that lives might be adjusted to your will. Forgive us for our transgressions, Lord, and create in us clean hearts, that we might know how to serve you, that we might know how to get along and treat each other. As we love you, Lord, help us to love our brothers and our sisters. Help us to know how to be a church, how to be your children, and how to win others to the faith. I thank you for it, Lord, and I praise you for it. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We're blessed today to have Sister Anya, young Sister Anya Covington. She is an advocate, an organizer, a trainer, a coach, and more importantly, she's a messenger of God and a teacher of the word. Yeah. Amen. And we're just so excited to be a part of her life and have her a part of our ministry. And I think she's a dynamic young lady. And you know what I'm talking about. You've heard it before. And I'm just proud to be a sponsor and an advocate of her, Sister Covington. Amen.
This on. Have you ever been wrecked by the word of God? Just by the word. If you can just sing that again, Miss Lesa.
I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe. Feel your heart beat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. Overwhelming joy, overwhelming love, overwhelming peace, overwhelming grace. It's overwhelming.
Dear Lord, we thank you for overwhelming us with your spirit. Lord, I thank you for allowing us the privilege to sit at your feet. Lord, I thank you for how you have kept us. If we are able to hear the sound of my voice, Lord, if we are able to breathe, Lord, if we are able to see, if we are able to hear, if we are able to use our mind to whatever capacity we are allowed, Lord, I say thank you. Lord, I say thank you. For every tear we're able to shed, for every obstacle we've been brought through. Lord, I thank you for the truth of your word. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. Lord, I thank you for never tempting us beyond what we can bear and always showing us a way out, which is being at your feet, adhering to your spirit, and keeping you as Lord of our life. Lord, I thank you for the precious opportunity we have to commune together in this hour. Lord, I thank you for Miss Howard. I thank you for how she responded to you this morning as she prayed with me. Lord, I pray that right now I die to myself fully, and it be your spirit that speaks. Lord, I thank you for using Miss Lesa Thank you for blessing her with this song. Lord, I pray that we always recognize that in all that we do, it is to worship you. So as we continue to worship in word and in deed, Lord, I pray that it be transformative, Lord. I pray that we don't go back to the same thinking we had before. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Jackson, the head of this church, Lord. I thank you for Miss Jackson, Lord. I thank you. Continue to use them, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You are in control. We ask these things in your precious and holy name, Jesus. Amen. Well, all right. I must say God has wrecked my soul. You know, a few years ago, I wouldn't have got up here if I was crying. You know, I would have pulled that together. But at the end of the day, God has wrecked my soul. And I'm going to just say it clear and plain because we're gonna upbeat this conversation here in a second. But I got to stay right here. Because we've all been through some things. And if you have, if you need to cry out, it's okay. If you need to moan with no words, it's okay. If you just need to sit at God's feet, it's okay. If you need to lean on somebody else's shoulder, it's okay. It's okay. If you need to rejoice, it's okay. Clap your hands, stump your feet. If you just need to lay out, do what you got to do, it's okay. God said, come as you are. And so here we are. And God wrecked my soul this morning. It woke me up at 6. And all I could do was be in his presence. And read his word. And then as I was reading, he quieted my soul and he said, yea, be quiet. Receive my spirit and let me wreck you. Because it's in your weakness and in your brokenness that God stands strong. Because see, when I think I've got it together, I'm not giving glory unto God. I'm standing in the righteousness of me, which ain't nothing right about it without God. So I stand before you broken. God wrecked my soul for many hours this morning. And so, Miss Catherine, you listen to the Lord. I'm glad that you still got that on cue. Not quite yet. But I'm not going to shy away from what God's put on my heart. So here we go. This is what it is. How many of you feel like you're in the middle of a battle? Yes. All right, Ms. Tawana, hello. In the middle of a battle. Yes, EJ. In the middle, yes, sir, of a battle. Well, I got one thing to say at the beginning. God has already got the victory. And when we walk in him, when we proclaim him as Lord of our life, as believers, thus we do too. That does not mean that we won't go through the valley of the shadow of death. But what it does mean is we will fear no evil. And so we have two options. We have two options. We can decide, since we're in the middle of this battle, to wage war or be enslaved by the lather. We got two options. There is no in between. There is no fence walking on this. I've got to decide that I'm going to wage war, which is active, which is the aggressor. If I were to give a basketball terminology, that means I'm on the offense. It means I'm getting buckets. Or am I going to be enslaved, which we're going to talk about here today, but I am going to have us loosen up our joints here in a second. So bear with me, because it's going to be a little bit of change of pace, and I hope that y'all can ask me to come back. But we got two options. We wage war, or we be enslaved. So with that being said, I told y'all, God wrecked my soul. I sent my little sermon points in. I shouldn't say little. God put it on my heart. But then this morning, he was like, no, I need you to stay on the first one. I need you to stay on waging war and what that looks like as believers. And then maybe if you call me back, we could talk about how we get suited and booted for the war, okay? How we have to take captive, take prisoners of war. And I know all about this talk because my father served in the military. So we had these conversations. I got to witness. I got to see how he got ready before he left for war, literally. To go to another country to fight, for us to be here today. So I know what that looks like and all that. And but then there's another thing that hit me too, was that we gotta be ready. We won't talk about that too much today. And then the last one is understanding our assignment as soldiers. So if you ask me to come back, I could dive more into those. But today, we're going to focus on waging war. And so what I'm going to ask you to do, no matter where you're at, if you're at home, if you got your house coat on or your slippers, or you're here with your heels on and your nice shoes, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I told you we're going to change pace this morning. So when we talk about waging war, we've got to get ready to do battle. And oftentimes when you think of war, you think of the army, correct? When I think of that, again, my dad served in the army, so that's the first thought for me, the military. And so that means what that brought to my mind is that not only do I have to be ready, but we got to be ready. And we have to understand that when we are in the middle of a battle, it's not just you. First of all, you have the victor already. God is right there in it with you. I mean, he's right there. His spirit is in you if you have received him. Number two, he did not create us to live this life alone. Thus, you have community. No matter how lonely it feels, we have it. So when we talk about an army, I'm not just talking about you. You're not just going through the valley of the shadow of death by yourself. You have the Holy Spirit that's within you. God has gone before you. He is around you, and he's got your back. But that's also why he's given us community. So this song is by KB. He's an artist. And I know for all the younger people, if you like the beat, great. But I'm going to have y'all walk with me this morning as soldiers in the army to this. I want you to hear the lyrics. We're only going to go to the 2-minute and 3-second mark, Miss Catherine, if that's okay. I'm going to take my little green jacket off because I did wear my pearls today in honor of our MVP, who is our new vice president. And yes, my shirt says woman. That is no political stance. That is an honor of the women who have gone before us and done some great things. So I hope all the young girls out there understand that through God, all things are possible. So with that being said, I'm going to have y'all walk with me. You can go ahead and play that song, Miss Catherine. I want y'all to listen to it. And I'm going to show y'all how we're going to walk. All right. Here we go. Play it all the way through. Start from the beginning all the way to the 2-minute mark, if that's okay. So, y'all, we got a little beat going. I want y'all to walk with me. If you haven't got any exercise in today, we're going to walk. You can just move your shoulders. If you can only move your hands, that's fine. If you don't move your head, that's
yeah. Danger, giants, battle is my story. But alone, I won't know. That's my glory. Shadows who cannot hide me. My king will fight. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Because y'all, Ms. Jackson, I saw you. We got the army right here. Holy Spirit within. And we're going to talk about what we're waging war on. So I hope that got your energy going. If you broke a sweat, praise God. Okay, because we got to keep our bodies moving, all right? We got to keep our mind moving. We got to stay fresh. We got to understand that these temples of ours are borrowed, that the Holy Spirit lives in us. So please walk, do what you got to do to remain healthy. And so our scripture today Again, if I'm allowed to come back, I will stay in this scripture while diving into a few other ones. We'll come out of 2 Corinthians chapter 10. So we're going to talk about waging war. Absolutely. We're waging war, or we're being enslaved by the lather, which we're going to dive into here today. So forgive me, because I just love the word. I love touching it. I love looking at it. And so I'm going to flip to it really quick. There we go. I'm in Galatians. Remember, it's 2 Corinthians. I think it's going to be on the screen here for you, chapter 10. I'm going to start at 2b, and I'm going to go on down to 6. And this is what the word of God says. Now, I'm reading from NIV. I know you can see it on your screen. I'm going to start in the middle of verse 2. Am I there, God? Where is it? There we go. Some people who think that we live by the standards of this world, for though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient. Yes, we take captive of every thought. We take captive of every thought to make it obedient to Christ. And we will be ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. So I already explained those 5 points God had put on my heart. I'm only going into to point one today. And that is, if you look at verse 3, it says it clear and plain. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. Though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. So I'm going to put it to you like this. There's a lot of wars that we can discuss right now, right? We can go back in history. We can go here today. We got a war that we've seen played out on TV. Right, Ms. Jackson? We got a divided nation. We have a divided people. We have divided churches. I mean, we're in the middle of a war when we talk about it, right? Two sides against each other, or maybe even multiple sides. If I were to say it plainly, and again, oh, I need to put my jacket back on, y'all. I'm sorry. It's not of God. But again, we are in war, you all. Thank you. Absolutely. And that's what we're going to get into today. Because we can look outside of ourselves, right? And we can name all these wars that are happening. Again, we're divided. We had a legislation, you know, in Illinois that has now further divided us in terms of police and citizens. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you got to look it up. But you all, this goes deep. But what goes deeper is the number one war that we are fighting every moment of every day is the spirit versus the flesh. That's the war. When we see people acting in a way that's unrighteous, you all, that is a war they're having between their spirit and their flesh. It's greater than black versus white, than brown versus black, than black versus blue, than church versus church, than denomination versus denomination. Y'all, we are talking about a spiritual battle. And until we can get to that point, we won't resolve the other ones. All those are just results of the internal issue. So I'm asking you today, are you ready to wage war spiritually? All right, so if you would like, you don't have to. Like I said, we're coming out of the context of 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 today, which is, we're not of this world, thus we don't wage war as the world. So how do we wage war? So let's go to Galatians, if you would like, chapter 5. Initially, I was only going to do a few verses, but God got me this morning, so we're going to just flow on through there. So I hope that you take the opportunity to read Galatians chapter 5. I mean, even starting with verse 1, it got me. It is deep. I love how the word of God shows us ourselves, shows us who we are becoming, and shows us the way. To me, the word of God is no secret. It's very clear and it's very plain. And I just love it. And this is why it wrecked me. But I want to start at verse 13. And we're gonna dive into this. And at the end, I really want you to contemplate if you are ready to wage war or be enslaved by the lather. So verse 13, and I think I'm going to read on down to 17. It says, "You, my brothers and sisters," again, community, our army, "were called to be free." So I lied. I'm not going to go down to 17. I'm going to stop right there. "We're called to be free. And we're talking about believers. We're talking about those who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. Now, Jesus has opened up salvation for all people. So if you're listening and you don't know who Jesus Christ is, he is our Savior. He is the one that came down here over 2,000 years ago and walked this earth blamelessly. He was tempted by all things that we have been tempted by. And he showed us the ultimate form of love by sacrificing his life on the cross. Unimaginable. Being betrayed by people that he loved. Being ostracized by people that he was going to sacrifice his life for. He died for divided people. And he rose after 3 days. So we would have the opportunity to have his saving grace. To go to him and repent, confess with our mouth, and believe in our heart that he is Lord. So that's what we're talking about today. We talk about this spiritual matter. When Jesus ascended after 40 days left, after he rose, what descended was his Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit lives in us. Thus, we have this war within us because we are born sinners in our flesh. Like we are born. We crave to satisfy our flesh. For example, I was fasting, okay, from sweets, right? As soon as I finished, I mean, I was dreaming of ice cream and every shape and form. I was like Cold Stone or Culver's today. You know, like which one am I going to go to? Even though Baskin Robbins is my jam. And it's amazing. Like my flesh craved it, even though I knew that I've been called to discipline and I've been called to live a healthier life. So thus, I can be about the Lord's business in the way He has called me to. Yet the thing that and it sounds simple, right? It's ice cream. Yay! What you mean? It's ice cream. Exactly. It's a temptation. It's a temptation for me because I know what God has called me to. It's just amazing how that works. I want to use a basic example because I'm about to get deep with you. What is keeping you from being free? What are you bounded by? Is it past hurt? Possible abuse? Is it comparison? Unforgiveness, bitterness, for sure. Is it approval of others? I'm not going to lie to you. That got me this morning. I was like, Lord, are they going to approve of what I have to say? And he said, if I go before you, then you speak my word. Is it greed? Is it generational curses? Let's speak to it. Is it addiction? What are you bounded by? What is preventing you from freely walking as God has called you to be? What have you not yet waged war on that you are being enslaved by? Oh, for me, it's pride. Wow, it's pride. For me, it's trying to control all that I can control and only trust God with the areas that I've already seen the vision for. I know that check is coming. God, you're a provider. I'm just going to be honest with you. And I'm going to keep naming a few things because the Lord put it on my heart. So I'm going to say, are you bounded by poverty of mind? Can you not see past your situation? Are you bounded by faithlessness? There is no hope. This is who I'll be. This is what they said I was going to be. This is, Are you bounded by hope in man, not in God? Rude awakening, man will fail you. I will fail you. Humans are imperfect, y'all. Jesus is the only human to walk this earth perfectly. So are you bounded by hoping in man versus your Lord? Are you bounded in serving yourself? You know, with your needs. Again, our fleshly desires. Are you bounded by religion? Remember, religion is man-made. Our God supersedes. What are you bounded by? Are you bounded by tradition? This is how we've always done it. This is what great-grandmother did. Just one more. Are you bounded and judgment of others. I'm just, and it could be multiple. You know, as I was naming these, I was like, Lord have mercy. I for sure have been a Bible thumper. Well, you do this and I just gossip. Excuse me? Excuse me? Sin is sin. God does not see one sin greater than the other. And he's called us to be free. So if he's called me to be free, I cannot be enslaved and be free. The contradiction is that. I cannot claim Christ, yet walk in chains and shackles of anything named or anything unnamed. Is it sexual immorality? Is it lustful thoughts? I mean, we can keep going all day, but I'm gonna let that go. Because you know what you're bounded by. I know what I'm bounded by. And God has called us, y'all. He's called us. And I love that word called, because that means you were in a situation and he is telling you to come out. That don't mean it's gonna be easy. That doesn't mean that it's gonna look like what the world shows us. Right? Absolutely, Pastor Jackson. He's called us out. So I have to receive the call. I've got to answer it. And before that, I've got to hear his voice. How in tune are you with your Lord and Savior? I can't wage war spiritually without the Spirit. God got me this morning. Oh, yeah, you want to get up in front of people and you haven't sat in my presence. You want to get up and tell other people what you think I'm telling you. Yet you're not allowing my Spirit to rule you. I'm so grateful he wrecked me this morning. Or I don't know, you know. So I'm just grateful. I'm just grateful. So y'all, we've been called to be free. We've been called to be free. Let's continue in his word. I didn't get past the first line, Lord. Okay, so it's still verse 13. You, my brothers and sisters, again, are army. We're called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Okay, we're just going to go word by word really quick. So we're called to be free, right? So again, I'm called as a believer to walk as Jesus walked, to not be held down or enslaved by the things of this world that does not allow me to use my freedom out of God's will. It doesn't allow me to use my freedom to put anybody else down. It doesn't allow me to use my freedom in Christ, knowing that I'm saved and I'll be going to live in eternity with the Lord. Thus, that makes me better. It doesn't allow me to sin and be like, God will forgive me. It doesn't allow me to perpetrate one thing and live another. But it says, rather serve one another humbly in love. Okay. Yeah. So serve other people. I do serve other people. I give. I give of myself. I give of my time. It says humbly. How often do we talk about what we do? God got me. I'm going to give you an example. The other day I was like, listen, I've coached college basketball for 8 years. I've done this. I've done that. So I would know how to tell you how to, you know, do a jump shot. That's not the example that I had, but it was something like that. And God wrecked me this morning, brought that exact point back in my life. It's like, why did I have to run down all the things that I've done? Why? There was no humility in that. That was my pride. That was me just like, you should listen because. I know I'm changing my voice. Y'all pray for me. Pray for me. Pray for me. Pray for me. So when we say humbly, it is without prestige and power. It's lowliness, it's meekness. No, it does not mean that you don't think anything of yourself. I like the saying, you know, you think of yourself less often. I'm not just dwelling in on my emotions every moment of the day. And then when I want to do something, I profess what I want to do, how I want to do it. There's no humility in that. Humility is confidence in God, that he goes before you. All right, and then in love, and God is love. Simple as that. So that's the characteristics of God. So I'm going in the power of God, acting in his character. That's how I serve other people. Okay, now again, we're talking about waging war, but I had to, you know, continue to expound upon what the word of God says. So we continue, it says, for the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. Let's talk about war. Let's talk about war. We're biting and we're devouring. That's what war is. We destroy, right, Mr. Pitts? One side has got to overtake the other side. When we talk physically, when we talk about in person, when our armies go over, or people try and come over here, Lord Jesus, we pray for safety. But let's talk about it. It's biting and it's devouring. And it's crazy to me because Paul, this is his second letter to the church of Corinth, and he's using this example. You cannot bite and devour each other. So let's think about our lives, our words. Our reactions, are we biting and devouring one another? So then we're enslaved by something, you all. You may think that we're waging war, but when we talk about this waging of war spiritually, it has zero to do with how bad I can cut you with my tongue. I'm going to give an example because this is what hit me, right? So I could look at January 6th, and in my opinion, the terrorism on the Capitol, and I could be like, oh, who, whatever. I could start listing all the things that come to mind when I saw what I saw. But if I did it as a black woman, And that might be justified. But is that what God has called me to? Did I actually get to the root of it? That every human being that has hurt someone, that has terrorized something, that has caused pain, that has murdered, that has gossiped, that has lied, that has stolen, that has condemned, they chose their flesh. Let's just call it what it is. If I get biblical with this, well, what we are seeing every day of our life is spirit versus flesh. Every day of my life, what I witnessed on January 6th was spirit versus flesh. And I got to call a thing so I can walk as God's called me to in freedom. Because see, when I walk in my flesh, I'm bounded by anger. I'm bounded by bitterness. I'm bounded by comparison. I'm bounded by my past hurt. And then mad about their privilege. I'm bounded. They're taking pictures. I'm bounded. God has not called me to that. He has called me to freedom. So I have to decide in that moment to rage war. And I'm saying war, this spiritual war, is every moment of every day. This is not just when we went to Iraq. No, this is like I woke up this morning and my mind wasn't set on Jesus. I'm waging war. I'm waging war on those thoughts. They're distracting me from my Heavenly Father. When I get up and my dad made pancakes and meat, and I said, I'm not doing bread and meat. I've got to rage war on those temptations to go indulge when I know I've decided to fast. This morning, y'all, this morning. Udon pancake, then, well, I don't know what he made. It smells so good. Thank you, Jesus. But I've got to wage war. I've got to rage war. And I got something for, I don't know how this is going to be received, but I'm just saying what it is, the way God gave it to me. If my blackness supersedes the fact that I've been created in God, I've got to wage war. It doesn't. It doesn't. And when we get, if you continue to read in Galatians chapter 5 and it starts naming all the things, right? We talk about, let's get to verse 16. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desire of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you will. So, oh God, I can read. So that you are not to do whatever you want. And it's crazy because I just told y'all right in verse 13, I didn't tell you the word said, you're called to be free. And so this is what interesting. So does that mean that I have no Lord, no Savior, no Master? No, I'm freely enslaved by Jesus. You got to serve a master. I'm serving somebody. So when we talk about freedom, it's not just, we just out here No, I have claimed Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Thus I will serve him. Thus I will wage war on anything that goes against him. And if that is not the case, then my master is my flesh. It's me. It's me. Like, I think we can get into naming all of these idols. Nah, it's either Jesus or it's me. It's either the Holy Spirit or it's me. And it shows up in all these sinful ways. But it's either God is my Lord and my idol, or I am. And so when it gets to listing all these things, right, the acts of flesh down in verse 19 are obvious. Sexual immorality, which we obviously you can dive into that, impurity and debauchery. I want to stop right here at idolatry. Idolatry. So I'm idolizing something. Something is Lord. It is what I worship. Which is probably the same thing that has you bounded and enslaved. The thing that you worship. Do I worship my emotions? Do I worship temporary feelings? Do I worship the approval of others? Do I worship? What do you worship? When ain't nobody around, what you thinking about? In your loneliest moments, what's on your mind? What's pushing you to do or not do? You'll find your idol. What are you spending your money on? That's what got me. So it showed me where my, Lord have mercy, where my heart was when I looked at my finances. Have mercy. Right there, I can see where my idol is. And right there is where I have to wage war. Because Jesus is Lord, y'all. He already has the victory. We heard the lyric in the song. Okay? Life changed when death died. When Jesus took out Satan, okay? When he conquered death in the grave, life changed for each and every one of us. Thus, we have a way. We have an example. And we have, y'all, we've already won the war. Every moment we choose Christ over our flesh. Every moment we decide to walk in our spirit versus our flesh. But this is the catch. It ain't easy. So as we continue to read, I'm going to give a few examples as I read, and then I'm going to digress. So it gets into all these things that show signs of the flesh. Again, idolatry is that big thing. And I just, okay, so we could talk about idolatry. We could talk about January 6th. We could talk about what it looks like to serve a man. We could talk about what it looks like to be consumed. But how many of us are consumed by something else outside of God? I'm just trying to humanize this thing. How many of us? So if we continue to go and then we get into the fruit of the Spirit, which we all probably know so well, and we can recite it. But you all, this is the difference. In my flesh, I'm all these things from verses 19 to verses 21. And then in the Spirit, I am these things. I am these things, okay? But the fruit of the Spirit is love. And you all, that's an action. I know we talked about this before. I was up here before, Pastor Jackson. Y'all know what love is, but I want to give it to you like this. To walk in the Spirit is active. It's aggressive. To love somebody, I have to proactively sacrifice. I've got to have them in mind. This isn't reactionary. My flesh is reactionary. Oh, I feel this way, so I'm going to get ice cream. That's reactionary. That's my flesh. But to actually walk in the Spirit, it's the aggressor. How can I love them today? How will I pray for them today? It's me like waking up and actively seeking the Lord. Matthew 6:33, seek first his kingdom. Love is action. We got to get after it. And then when we do that, y'all, then yes, joy, right? That's humility and recognizing God and everything. Peace, that is confidence. But that is me dying to all kinds of things. It is active. When I think of being, you know, an athlete all these years, like, I can't show up to the game and be ready. It was all them years of running for that moment, for that opportunity to serve, that opportunity to display the gift. It was all them opportunities that I had to lift weights and to go to bed early and to get up early and to eat right and to train my body for the moment. So again, if we're raging war, y'all, it's time to get ready. That means it is like a daily, I got to do this. I've got to train my mind. I've got to make it a habit. I've got to make it a pattern. Because I will win in Christ. But it's just not a proclamation of word. It is in action and in deed. which starts our thoughts, which is a whole other day. I just want to keep going. We got into the fruits of the Spirit. I love it. And then verse 25, it says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Come on. That's why we were walking, Mr. Pitts. We were walking in the Spirit, together, united as believers. We walked. And it is just a semblance of how we are to walk each and every day, hand in hand with the Lord, you all. And that might mean, again, that we might be walking through the valley of the shadow of death. We may be walking through cancer. We may be walking through loss of loved ones. We may be walking through loss of jobs. We could be walking through all kinds of things, but where is my hand? And what have I proclaimed? I have waged war on anything that could enslave me or keep me in that moment that is not of Christ. And I do it every moment of every day. Last but not least, I'm going to get into chapter 6. I know y'all are like, Anya, what are you doing? But I have to. So it says, brothers and sisters, our army, come on. If someone is caught in sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. Why? What does this have to do with waging war, Anya? Why are we here? We're here because, again, we're a village. We're an army. There is not one person in an army. Okay, we got all kinds of positions, we got all kinds of things. The body of Christ is an army. We are an army. I think of Tasha Cobb's song, Break Every Chain. Her second verse says, there's an army rising up. It is me and it's you, it's God's body. We are rising up each and every day, a spiritual movement. So as I am walking with the Spirit, you all, to walk in love, is to make sure if I have a brother or a sister falling, I'm able to help them get up and walk alongside. When I reach for Jesus' hand, that leaves me with another hand. Who am I grabbing onto? If I'm going to wage war, I can't wage war by myself. I'm waging war with Jesus. But to walk as Jesus, I got to bring along somebody else. Anybody, my neighbor, which could be that same neighbor that has different beliefs than me, that looks different than me, that sin is different than mine. He didn't say only talk to the one that looked like you, talk like you, walk like you. And so thus we've been called. And if I were to use an example, okay, black people, we've always had an open culture, take in whoever, do with whoever. But what if your neighbor is white and a Trump supporter? And God's called us to love them. God has called us to love them. Well, why are we always asked to love everybody else, even though we've been treated such a way? Does my blackness supersede me being created in Christ? Does it? Does me being woman supersede me being created in Christ? Because if it does, I have an idol. I have an idol that is keeping me bounded. And y'all, I am talking to myself. I am 100% talking to myself when I say this. But if my neighbor is this and this and this and that, profess Jesus, then okay. I've been called to walk alongside you as I am walking with Jesus hand in hand, waging war each and every day on anything that could enslave me that's not of Christ. I have this other hand here. Come on, my brother. Let's finish it up. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. But watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. So again, we're waging war every moment of every day, because as soon as I want to help somebody, then I have stepped outside the will of God, so I haven't done what I need to do so I can help somebody. Y'all, I could be tempted by the very same thing. I could be enslaved by somebody else's enslavement. Their enslavement becomes mine. So I'm walking with the Lord, and I go over here, and I'm talking to somebody that's been gossiping about so-and-so and so-and-so. But I don't have this hand holding on to my Father that already has a victory. Thus, I become enslaved with gossiping. I'm giving a very slight example because, you know, sometimes we see gossip as, oh, like a little white lie. A sin is a sin. Verse 2, chapter 6, carry each other's burdens, period. Period. We've been called to, you all. We wage war on what's ailing us. And yep, we grab a hold of somebody else. Yep, We take on that burden because all I've done is take it on to give it away to my Heavenly Father. And I see them through how God sees them, through the Spirit. I see me how God sees me through His Spirit. So thus, I'm actually not carrying their burden. I've given it to the Lord. But if I see their burden as theirs, well, they're ignorant, they don't understand, well, they don't see us, this or that, blah, 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 then I have become the very thing that I have called them. I have become enslaved by what's not of God. Think if Jesus had did that. The Samaritan woman at the well. Well, you know what? Our people don't get along. She's not worthy to be saved or for me to reach my hand out. Because we're all technically, we're not Jewish. If I were to say it plain. And he was like, well, you know, I got my chosen people. Think of where we would be. I'm just going, okay, all right, I'm going to end it. Here we go, God. Thank you, Jesus. If anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. The word is preaching itself, so let's just read. Each one should test their own actions. Wage war on you first. Gratify the Spirit first in you. And He will guide you on what to do with anybody else, how to hold that hand out, how to be, how to walk. All right, Lord. Then they can take pride of themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. For each one should carry their own load. Nevertheless, the one who receives instruction in the word should share all good things with their instructor. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please his flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. The word of God, y'all, powerful. Can't be misconstrued right there. So don't matter how many times. I love you. Don't be a fool, but I love you. I'm going to finish it with this. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers, no matter denomination, no matter sin, no matter how they may appear when they come into your presence. We have decided to wage war on the things that have enslaved us that are not of God. So thus we are free to serve our Jesus, our Lord and Savior, with all of us in thought and in deed. So I ask you, are you ready to wage war? Wage war together as God's army. Y'all be blessed. Thank you.
Yes, I'm grateful for the victories we've won. I could go on and on about your words, because I'm grateful, grateful, so grateful, Lord, to praise you, Lord. Flowing from my heart, you all can help me sing it. All the issues of my heart. Oh, oh yeah. Oh yeah. Let's pray for that. I want to hear you. Let's do it again. I am I am, yes, yes, I'm to reap we won. I could go on and on about your works. Because I'm to praise you, Lord. Yeah. Flowing from my heart. All the issues of my heart. Oh, Lord.
Amen. Gratefulness. Amen. I apologize. I didn't have the mic on a little while ago, but I'm grateful for this message and for this messenger, and for I'm so glad God sent her our way. Amen. And you'll be hearing from her some more. But I got a whole, well, not a whole, but I got a 3/4 of a page of notes. Amen. Good stuff that she shared with us. Amen. I thank God for that. Now, if you have joined God's army and you weren't in, or if you just want to testify that I am in, type it on the screen. Type it on there and say it's in, you know. Me too. We don't want to be in the army by ourselves. We were not by ourselves, and we need each other. If one falls, then if you by yourself and you fall, you fail. But if somebody's to your right and somebody's to your left, then they're going to pressure you to get up. If you get down and you fall, you stay down. But if somebody is loving you and encouraging you, then you just might be able to get up and continue. Amen. So I just thank God for the war that we're in. I thank God that I can fight. I don't have to just give in to my pride. It's there. I don't have to just give in to every temptation. You know, I tell young people all the time, if you can't tell yourself no, if you can't tell yourself no sometimes, you're doomed. Sometimes I got to tell me no. No, don't say that. No, don't think that. Change the conversation of your mind. That's a subject you ought not be on right now. And that's what temptation, you know, you got to say no. Even when you want to. Donnie, you ever want to? No, I'm not going to. Amen. God bless you. Well, we thank God for you sharing with us today. And Anya, God bless you. God bless you. Amen. We're praying for her. And God can use her, I know, and people like that who love him. Yes. Who love him. Amen. Keep us in your prayer. If you got a testimony, if you made a decision today, don't keep it to yourself. Share it. Put it in the chat. Is that what he puts up? Amen. You know what? I'm in the army too. I'm fighting those things that are trying to bind me up. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us henceforth, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.
Shoes up.